young man said something in English, and Dr. Obenga said, no, 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 no. That's not what I said. So he was in camouflage. So, you know, he says his English is not that good. He understands it, but you do need to put your ear up, but don't say that he said something, because he'll correct you whether you're in English or in French. And then he went through the word philosophy and showed the origins of the word itself. And so the more he got into the presentation, the more Europeans started exiting the room. The more Africans started shouting. You know how we do. And so by the end of the presentation, when Dr. Obenga was through, we were standing on the table top.
You're going to sit right here?
No, yes.
Jeffrey was up on the stage, hollering and shouting.
I'm hooking you up.
Sharsha McIntyre was just waving her hand like she just didn't care. So, brothers and sisters, without any further ado, I present to you Dr. Theophile Obenga.
I love you, man.
Yes. Hotep. So I will try to speak in English now. Thank you, Queen Zinga, President. Dr. Ben, thank you for coming. And now you live in New York, it's not too far. And this is the hometown of Dr. Jeffries. He told me that. So you are very happy to be here. It's cradle too. So we have three cradle. And afterward, Dr. Thompson and Dr. Jones said, it's very difficult to talk because almost the same. I will repeat almost the same things. So when we study what we call classical studies, we must know medu nature. You see, maybe in the future we need to know some Emeritic too. We need to know medu nature. And then, you see, it's connected with Asia. We must know, some of us must study some Hebrew, chiefly Arabic, and Gez. And then some Arabic too, because our classical studies, they're very long studies. It starts in Kemet. You have Ethiopian classical period in Ethiopia with beautiful philosopher like Zara Yaqob. And you go to Sankore, Tombuktu. They study in Arabic. So it's part of classical studies too. So we must try to handle these things by ourselves. Study medu nature, some Giz, some Arabic, some Hebrew, some Greek too, because Kemet was linked by all this civilization. And two, one of the remarks is about education. So education is the most difficult thing in the world, in humanity, everywhere. It's very difficult, education. To teach what and for what? To achieve what? Usually when we fight in the United States and Africa, usually it's about the content of the education, more mathematics, more calculus, more computer, but we don't teach for the philosophy, which kind of education. We don't fight for philosophy of education. We fight for the content of the curricular programs, and not for the mind frame of the education. Because in Western civilization, from kindergarten to university, from kindergarten to PhD, there is no change. It's the same philosophy. The content can change. MA, BA, MA, BS, until PhD. But the philosophy doesn't change. This is why they don't fight for their philosophy. It's there already. They fight for just to do more mathematics so we can compete with Asian people, with Chinese people. But they don't change their philosophy. So we do the same. We follow them. We don't fight for philosophy on philosophical ground, on deep thought ground. We fight just for we need more mathematics, more calculus, something like that. But for them, the philosophy is there. Since kindergarten to PhD, it's the same philosophy. First, you don't teach religion. There is no spirituality. You don't teach spirituality in kindergarten. You don't teach spirituality in PhD. There is no, it's empty of, how to say that, of religion, let's say, of spirituality. It's empty, completely empty. Because the society wants to be a science and technology society. That's all. So we do the same, we do the same. So in antiquity, President Zing asked me to talk about my recent book. It's in French. Egypt, that means Kemet, Greece, and School of Alexandria, Alexandria School. So it's always about education. So the most achievement in Kemet for me is education. The way they think, they build, and they practice their education is very unique in history. You don't succeed like that. This is why they have pyramids, they have texts, they have this cosmogony, but basically is they have teachers like Imhotep, like Ptahotep, like Kagemni, a lot of them. These teachers are the best teachers in the world, you see? So education is the most achievement in Kemet, in humanity. Even Greek or Greek civilization, their education, we'll see. Their education, it was just for pigs. I didn't say that, but themselves they said that. So education, it was the key in Kemet. This is why they make this grandiose civilization. Without education, I believe there will be no Kemet. It is a question of education. We can call that many names, education, intercommunication, transmission of knowledge, but it's education. How they did that? So briefly, I will give the idea because we don't have enough time. So next, just got that, I will make comment. So you know, this is the book of Plato, the laws, chiefly the book 7. Next. Yeah, we rush your time. So this book, he said that it's good to have kids, but it's not enough. We need, if you have kids, it's not enough. We need a trophy and a paideia, education. Trophy, that means to nurture kids. And the paideia, we have pedagogy, to give them education. You need two things. You see, you need to nurture students and education, you see. Not that our children, both male and female, they need to be nurtured by us in the Greek schools, and they need to be educated so we can build civilization. So this, we don't discuss that. It's okay for everyone. That's okay. But which kind of education then? And Plato goes on in studying Kemet education. And when he studied Kemet education, he said that Kemet education makes children more alert and more human beings. You see? Plato said that. When you go to Kemet school, you become more alert. You wake up, your spirit wake up. And you become a more human being. That's your character is built in a school. Next. But when you go to Greek school, you see, Greek school, according to Plato himself, he said that, you know, he became more alert and more human being. He became more, you see, Malone, became more human being. Not just human being, you became more yourself. You achieve your destiny when you go to Kemet school. You became a human being, more human. We are a human being already, but more human being. That means more wise. And when you go to Kemet school, When Plato himself compared what they do in chemistry school, I give Greek because no debate. You see, it's our school in Greece, the way we are doing things is just for creatures like pigs. You see, like pigs. You see, and he say myself, I'm ashamed. Myself as a plate, I'm ashamed. We do things like that, it's a shame. And also, not only for myself, as for all Greek, the Greek world is a shame. What we can do, our education, when you compare with a Kemet, is not even for human beings, it's just for pigs, for animals. It's said by Plato himself, you see. And the way he used that is very strong. The translation, they say, is not very good. He say, is the condition of a grizzling swine. You see, this is a translation. They keep the word swine, because the word swine is here. But what he says more than swine is not for tremator. That's for creator like pigs. Yeah, is for them. The way we are teaching in Greece is just good for creature like pigs. So our students are like pigs.
Yeah.
That mean what? That mean their education was no good. Yes. And he was ashamed of that. He said that in a low next. The translation is still the same, I believe. The translation is still the same. Next. Yes, it's always, I give many translations, say it will be the same. He will say always it's not for human beings, not for humanity, our education. You see, it's it doesn't belong to humanity, our education.
But to the offspring.
Yeah, to the
offspring.
Offspring, yes, you see.
Offspring.
Yeah, of some of the pigs. It belongs to the offspring of certain pigs. See, you see the judgment. So we believe that Greece has the best education. They teach that everywhere. But it worked for pigs. And this is a Plato, you see, pig, to compare your own education by a guy so brilliant like Plato, to say that is just for pigs, not for human beings. Meanwhile, in Greece, in Kemet, it makes kids more alert, more human beings. You can see how it's deep. You see? So this is the same. I give a lot of translation. The same, so let's move. It's the same pigs. So education in Greece is founded on philosophy. Yes, so if your education is for pigs, for swine, that means you don't have philosophy of education. If you don't have philosophy of education, you don't have philosophy itself. Because education, philosophy of education is just application of your philosophy first. This one, the word Sophia, philosophy, is what? Is obscure in Greek language and is a foreign language. Is a xenokon, xenoteron. Is very strange to us. Xenox is strange, foreign language. It's not a Greek word. This is why you don't have philosophy, so it's difficult to apply philosophy. Your education, by the way, is for pigs. You see the logic. They don't have a philosophy. The word philosophy is not a Greek word. You see? Yeah, they say Sophia, wisdom, Greek philosophy. This word is very obscure in Greek language. Very obscure and of foreign origin. So the word Sophia, wisdom, is not even a Greek word. They say that, they say, you don't explain this word in Greek. Is not only obscure, but is for foreign origin, you see. The Greek text is very clear. This word education is no good. I give this guy Reeves. This translation is no good either. So try. But it's good if you want, but try to put the better. I want the text.
Okay.
Yeah, this text here. Try to make straight and up.
Make straight.
Yes. Again. So he said that the word Sophia, wisdom, is rather obscure. He repeat obscure, and is non-attic. Well, in fact, the Greek doesn't say it's not attic. That means it's not a Greek word anyhow, to make more simple. Because attic was the Greek for Athens, the most beautiful Greek, is attic. So, it can be any dialect. It can be attic, Ionian, Dorian. It's not a Greek word, you see. It's not just the Greek of Athens. The old Greek dialect is not a Greek word. It must be like that, not just one dialect. You see? So, yes, so you can see the Sophia, the wisdom, Sophia, wisdom, is obscure in Greek. The Greek language doesn't know this word. It's a borrowing word. So it's a foreign word, you see? This is why you see they don't have the philosophy. So it's difficult to apply to build your education philosophy because you don't have philosophy. So in Kemet, they have a philosophy. They build their education on philosophy. You see the huge difference. Huge difference, you see. And this is Plato again. Yes, the same translation. I give the same translation, the same text. So you can see that the way they say, many translations, they agree that is obscure, is not. You see, this word translate that wisdom Sophia is very dark. Well, it's obscure. How a word can be dark? It's obscure. And appear not to be of a native growth. So it's not a native word in Greek. They don't translate exactly. Always try to wave. It's not not just. Dark is obscure, you don't understand. Nobody understands the word Sophia, philosophy in Greek. Wisdom, philosophy, the foundation. This is what they started cosmogony, like Yvonne said, by chaos. It makes sense now. So Sophia, so we check, this was said by Plato, I check modern scholarship. Modern scholarship, and chiefly people who study Greek etymology. And this guy, Pierre Chantrain, is one of the best in the world. He has a huge, maybe 10 dictionaries on etymology. He said that, briefly, there is no etymology. Even now, 2000, this year, you see, he publishes a book in Paris, Dictionnaire Etymologique de la Langue Grecque, the etymological dictionary of the Greek language. When you check, you go to the word Sophia, he says, pas d'étymologie, no etymology, there is no etymology. Even now, scholarship, Western scholarship recognize that the word philosophy or Sophia, Sophos, is not, you can make the, you can see the etymology, the beginning of this word in Greek. You see? Even now, so they concord what Plato said long, long time ago. You see? There is no etymology. So I don't say something I want to say, but it's like that, it's a fact. There is no etymology. Okay. Yes. So if you see this, the word. So in ancient teaching, we have Seba or Sebait. And they say, but it is abstraction word even. It's a kind of concept. It's a concept, say by it. It's a concept. You see, and we have the same word in a demotic. All stage of the Egyptian language, we have the word. Demotic, we have also sebat, you see, the same. And even Coptic, we have sebo, seba, the same word, you see. So you have the word through the evolution of the Greek, of the Egyptian language. And the Greek, of course, sophos, that's mean wisdom, something like that. So I try, the book is not about sophos only, but I spend at least 10 pages to explain that it came from Greek, it came from Kemet really. You must deal with linguistic level, and then you deal with cultural level, and with chronological level too, because time is a crucial, like I'm so used to say. So I spend time for that. So it's not just Sophia, you must the S came from where we have O here, where we have a phi, and the O again, Omicron again, Sigma again at the end. So with the behavior of this word in Greek itself. So it's difficult to find a word like this in Greek, if you know some Greek. It's difficult, this kind of structure. It must be something very strange, you see. Indeed, it is a very strange word. So you explain each level, each letter by letter, but you must explain why this one is there, why in Greek, in Egypt, you have a seba, it is a B, not a F. So why it became a F in Greek? Yes, and you explain, and you give some example too. Like we say neftis, neftis. But there is a nef f in Medunet, there is a b, is a b. Okay. Yes. So we have kind of anyhow. So when you have a Kemet, we know this Kemet, you have a transi, you have a Crete. And we have the Greek word is like from New York to here, is close, it's not very far. So you have a two road to come. You can from Greece, you can go from Crete, Greece, Crete, and then Medune, and then Kemet. Or Greece, you go to Asia Minor, and then Kemet. Is that you go by sea by that time? By sea is a pleo. You go by sea. You pay your ticket and you go. And we know the amount of the ticket, the price, is written by Plato. In a dialogue called Gorgias, is written, you pay 2 obols or 6 drachma. You pay the money, and from Athens and to Naucratis, you pay. Oh. Yes, it's written, so it's not fiction. So when you check these people, of course, since they don't have education, they don't have wisdom, they don't have nothing. So. You see? And this is the starting point, you see? They recognize that our education is for pigs. It's written about that. They recognize that the word of this sophos, sophia, wisdom, doesn't make sense to our language. That's me. Their education will come from somewhere, someplace else. This is why one of the founders of the early church, Omer, he said that the best doctor in medicine, we found them in Kemet. The best doctor to heal you, to cure you, it came from Kemet, not from the best in the world. They came from Kemet. You find them in Kemet. The best doctor in medicine, you find them in Kemet. Next, you say yes. This is by Omer. This one. Thales, if you have a time, I will focus on him because he's the first philosopher, the first wise. There are 7 wise only in antiquity. This is the first wise, the first philosopher, the first scientist, the first. So we can see his CV. He came from where? From Princeton, from himself, from dream, from where? So when you check his CV, he's one of the Kemet student, the first student. Oh. Yes, and he went back, he built a school there, the first. So after, if you have time, we'll focus on him special, like I did in a book. Mm-hmm. Next. So let's go quick, all of them. This guy is, they have the picture too. This is Solo. We give law, the lawgiver in Kemet. Solo, Solon. Yeah, he give law to Kemet, legislator, something like that. But he spend much of time in Kemet studying in Naucratis, in Sais Temple and then Heliopolis, Iunu. You see, he studied there to give law. Well, now they say the rule of the law. But the first people who give law in Western civilization, they were Kemet students. This is one of the first of them. Yes. Now they say the rule of law, they may spread the rule of law everywhere in the world. But they didn't start. They didn't start the rule of law. It was in Kemet. And this is the student who start that in Western civilization. Yes. You see? Now they pretend everything belongs to them. Now they give back to the world. You see? And this also, you see, all of them systematically, all of them. This one, Pythagoras. Of course, we know Pythagoras. There is no Pythagoras, you see. When the text said that, when Plato learned that these people, they have their knowledge from Kemet, so he decided to go to Kemet himself. Yes. And he built a school. He is one of the genius in wisdom, in philosophy, in Sophia, but they didn't have the word Sophia. So he spent 22 years in Kemet to study, in Memphis, Menefer, in Heliopolis, and Waset in Timbuktu. And he stayed there. They say, I want to know this, I want to go to the temple. They say, no, you don't go to the temple. He say, why? Because you are not circumcised, you see. You must be circumcised so you can go to the to go this place. He said, look, Dumutu, the first Greek in the world, in history, to be circumcised, this guy. Yes, the first. So he can go to the higher level to do his PhD, we can say. You see? Heraclitus. When you read this text, it came is a copy from books from Kemet. It's exactly the same. Yes. Chiefly the concept of change, but the change, transformation, happening is a Kepe. You find that everywhere in Kepe. The beetle, the moon is a Kepe. So in Greek, it's difficult to conceive the dynamic of the universe, the march, the motion of the cosmos. They didn't conceive that, you see. This is a Socrates. Socrates. No, Herodotus first. Well, Herodotus, you know, I don't have to tell you. He was there. You have the second book of his history. He deal with Kemet, so we know. Next. There's this picture, it's not me, but maybe it's real, maybe it's not fiction, but they present by sculpture their ancestors, you see. We must do the same, put Imhotep like this, Ptahotep, all of them. We must do our own picture now, our own sculpture. So this Socrates, he didn't go to Kemet as such, as far we can know, but he said that when I was young, I hear, oral tradition, that art, astronomy, geometry, even games in society, writing, tagramata, writing, came from Kemet. And the god Jeuti, he gave more detail, very detailed. Jeuti is a symbol, IB, something like that. He gave all details, so he's correct. He came. So he said, when I was young, I heard that all these things came from Kemet. He repeated that, you see. So this is the wisdom, the foundation of wisdom. It came from Kemet. They recognized that. So in fact, it was not stolen legacy. No. They stole, in antiquity, they recognized. But when we start slavery, colonization, for 13th century, 14th century, 15th century, they change the historiography. The way of writing history changed completely. How do you can say, I learn from you and make you slave? It makes no sense. You are my master, I make you slave now. I don't recognize that. I must destroy your mind and destroy my own mind too. Both. Yes. This is one of them too, one of the, spent five years in Kemet studying. They call the father of atomist theory. He spent five years in Kemet. studying their physics and what they call nature. Next, all of them systematically. I give picture in the book with detail, all of them. This one is a Plato himself. Plato has maybe 24 dialogues. In 12 of them, he gives a lot of detail concerning Kemet, a lot. Any kind of information you want on Kemet is a Plato. You can be king if you are not a priest. You can be something like that. A lot of information. And he was there. I said, I saw in a temple picture. I saw. He said that. You see? Next. So he was there. All of them, the best intellectual in Greece, they have connection. This by Plato too. Next. So I give you the what he said next. Yes. See, when Plato was taught in antiquity too, in school, they teach him too. So they say that when he learned from Pythagorean people, that the first arche, the first principle of their philosophy came from Kemet, from Egypto, he went, Eltheis Egypton, he went to Egypt. Plato went to Egypt. And when he stayed there, he left there after mastering completely. He stayed there, he stayed there in this country, and he left after mastering what? Geometry and hieratic science. That means hidden science, mysteries in the temple. So he stayed long to become a master of geometry. He was not geometry in Kemet. You see? This one said, he stayed, this is the translation. This next. This Aristotle too. You see, when Aristotle is a great, so he said like, dude, look, the old men in humanity are Kemet people, not us. They're old people. Their civilization is very old. Two, mathematics start, what we call mathematics, start in Kemet. Why? Because priests have a lot of time, they can study something like that. But the reason maybe is good or not good, but he said that mathematics start in Kemet. When try to translate, but it's more clear in Greek, you see. Mathematica technai sustesan. In Po Egypton, when the Peri Egypton, Peri does mean around Kemet. So they use the translation mathematics start around Kemet when you check the translation. So I check the Peri mean in fact the around Peri mean the around. But I check the best translation in Western civilization, Oxford people. So they don't translate. Around, how can be around? There is no around Kemet, then nothing is there. So they translate in Kemet itself. This is the best translation. So mathematics start, sustesan, that's the anteriority, the word anteriority is there in this kind of tense. You say sustesan, the anteriority start first in the beginning, start first, proton, start first. You see, he said, but Andy love Egyptian astronomy. He said they're the best because they have a debate on the comet. You see? And he said, no, the way we think is not right. The best way to think about this, everybody is a Kemet people. You must know that, you see? So, all of them, this is Plutarch, we talk about him too. This is Aristotle's student. So, yes, next. So, you see, all of them systematically, or what you call philosopher scholar, when you check one by one, you study them, where they came from, what they say themselves, all of them systematically have a link, connection, education with Kemet people, you see. You see, this is King Tut, of course. You know the picture, this one of the mask is African guy, the lips, the nose, everything. Now they try to change. If they give me a computer, Chinese computer, Tutankhamun will be like a Chinese. Yes, next. They're the same. You see, they're the same.
Yes.
So these people, they focus on education always. Yeah? Up you mighty race, up. That means we say educated first. And you can be up without education. Education can make student kids more alert and more human beings. So always up you is the same tradition of philosophy. You see? Yes, Kwame Nkrumah also, the same tradition, when he tried to build the consciousness, conscientism, to build African consciousness, for they must be aware of things, the awareness, build mad first. You see, even they didn't know, but this part of their tradition is your blood. You don't have to learn music always, you can dance, it's part of the blood. You see, it's part of our tradition. If we Kwame Nkrumah to conscientism, so we can build something new. Next, all of them. Julius Nyerere, we call him a teacher, Mwalimu in Kiswahili. He's a teacher. President of Tanzania, but he's a teacher. Yeah, we never call Western president teacher. No, never. Yes. Because in Kemet, it's like Imhotep, you teach. Teaching is crucial to us, you see. Teach, since Kemet, to teach, Sebaït, word bring back again by Essa, you see, to teach, not just to read and to spell, you see. To teach is to make more human beings. You see, to wake up his brain so he can achieve his own, by himself, his destiny, or by herself, her destiny is like that. So the Mwalimu is the Mwalimu of Tanzania, you see. And Jomo Kenyatta too was one of the great teachers in the continent, not just president. We must see them like they teach us a Pan-Africanism. They learned that from Marcus, from Du Bois. They teach us, let's be united. This is our way to achieve our destiny. You see, Jomo Kenyatta. We must live with our own image. We must live with our own philosophers. We must live with our own teachers. You see, yes. You see. And this Tom Mboya, he said, Uhuru, not yet. Yeah, not yet independence. We must fight again, not yet. Uhuru, not yet. You see? All these people, the most brilliant African 21st century, they continue the same legacy. Next, to teach, to build your conscience, check and third job, of course. You see, to teach, he taught me many things. So you must teach. If I did have the contact with check and third job, or Jake, something like that, I will miss something. We need the teachers, but African way, with philosophy, with foundation, with wisdom. Not just like we do, we fight for curriculum, more mathematics, more calculus, more readings. You waste your time, in fact. Because after that, you go back to reproduce Western civilization. Yes, there is no change. You produce their philosophy. Yes. This is a good comment, because they say, this is a good comment. Jake is a teacher of Africa, you see, he's not me. Instinctively, they know he was a teacher. Like Julius Nyerere, like Jomo Kenyatta, like Sheikh Anta Diop, like Kwame Nkrumah, like Up You Mighty Race, you see, like Marcus Garvey, all of them, you see. This is not my comment. It was made by this in the Chicago Weekly, you see, the teacher of Africa. Good title, teacher. You teach, it's a responsibility. See, it's a teach, a transmission of knowledge, of wisdom, of goodness, of medunature, medunefe, you see, of deep thought. You must teach. Education, to teach, to nurture, you see, is a deep. Next, like Ben, Jeffries, all these ASCAC teachers, you see, is basically teaching to study at the same time you teach. So this is the continent, we must map only this place too. This is our place, we must map, you see. This is the continent, you can put 10 United States. Yeah, if we build Africa as we'll be powerful than 10 times United States.
Yeah.
And we have all climate, all. We have snow, we have everything, grapes. We have grapes here in South Africa. They have grapes, they have everywhere. We have rainforest. I came from Congo, rainforest. Rest of the forest, the legs of the earth. So everything, we have all kind of climate. We have Atlantic Ocean, we have Indian Ocean, we have Red Sea, we have Mediterranean Sea, so we have a lot of seas. A lot of water, a lot of river, the wood, the savanna, steppes, all kind of climate, all kind of nature. It's a powerful place. So you have everything. And next, so, and then you can see even Kemet civilization. Kemet civilization, nothing came from outside, really. Because everything to build this civilization, you have ebony, it came from south. You have ivory, it came from south. You have even the symbol of mud, ostrich feather, it came from south. You have gold, it came from south. You see, everything, even when the Hatshepsut sent boat in Punt, everything came from south. There was, in fact, south people. They didn't, there was nothing to do with the Mediterranean Sea. Everything was here on the continent, with Nubia, Meroe, something, Napata, Ebony Feather, Erkouf went further than that. They have a connection with the deep south. They have a connection. They knew very well, you see. They went several times to an expedition. They know very well the Red Sea. It was known. The continent was known by them. Now they want to focus on the Palestine, something like that. But everything came from here. Even Albastra, Aswan, Granite, everything came from basically the south. Next, you see. Now they fight in Sudan. You know why? Darfur. Darfur is here, Darfur.
Yeah.
They fight. You know why? Where you have the oil. You have the pipeline. From this place, like this, like this, like this, like this, go to the Red Sea. This is a pipeline for oil pipeline. This is why they fight. If it was empty, we want to control. This is why you send humanitarian, humanity, Red Cross, all these people. They know, they have maps. Maps is a geostrategy, geopolitics. We don't do maps enough. We must map the world like it is. You don't go to Iraq because you love them to be Democrat. You go there because of purpose. You don't send Red Cross in Sudan. You must have a purpose. They know they want to control when you could see this huge oil from here, from Chad too. But Chad has that too. Chad has Chad, yes, there's a fight, so Darfur. Sudan, if you control this, you see Darfur, you control. So oil is crucial. Oil is now the foundation of industrial civilization. See? So this is why they fight, in fact. And the continent itself is a paradise. You see, try to do well. You see, they have everything there. For example, I don't read well. But you have bauxite, you have diamonds, you have gold, anything you want, coal, everything. You have everything where gold. You see, the Europe soil is almost empty. There is no diamond, no uranium, no bauxite, nothing there. Even United States is empty too. You see? The soul, maybe they don't tell us, but it seems to, there is no diamond, there is nothing. But the continent, you have everywhere. You can see the full of material, because we don't read very well the name. They have copper, iron, chrome, diamonds, gold, asbestos, bauxite, all kind of mineral, platinum, tin or tin, uranium to make nuclear bombs, you see, uranium, zinc, coffee, crops, all kind of crops, coconut, cocoa, palm oil, cotton, everything, tobacco, groundnuts, everything is there. If we decide, we can feed ourselves and humanity too. If we decide. Next, the last. Okay. But see, now is more specific, so we can stop there. Because I will give the detail to one just Greek, all details, so it will be too much, maybe kind of a panel. Kind of a workshop, maybe.
Yeah.
Yes, okay. Green single of that. And you have a chart too, like Anderson said, timing is crucial.
Can I announce your book?
Yes, the new one, yes. So thank you so much. You see, we have a lot to do. So let's study.
Excellent. Can I announce your book?
Yes. The book is there. This one
in French.
In French.
But I want my book now.
Yes, the book is there too.
Diane has it.
Yeah, in let's bring. Let me give you a next copy.
Diane.
So you can show.
I hope you enjoyed Professor Emeritus Théophile Obenga, and I'm sure there's a lot that you took from what you just watched. So at this point, we'll pass the mic around and have an interactive session. Okay? So who wants to share his or her observations, questions, comments with us first? Before we continue, I'd like to introduce Dr. Obadile Kambo and some of my colleagues. Promise. Yeah. My name is Nap, and we have the Sari and Akosia Manson. So when I give you the mic, you introduce yourself and then you share your thoughts with us.
Good evening. Thank you for this. I really appreciate it. I'm Carnita Groves. I guess I have a question, really. So as Dr. Obenga was talking about, there's not a translation or even a concept for the word wisdom or philosophy in the Greek language. And as he was showing that and then comparing it to the Merunetcher, where in ancient Kemet there were multiple words for it, my question is, were there any other concepts that approximated that came close, or was it just really just like real foreign, as he said, foreign in the general sense of the word or foreign in the specific sense of the word? Just out of curiosity. Not to question what he said at all.
Thank you very much. I'll hand it to Dr.
So in terms of the specific word Sophia, so that's coming from Seba. When you have what are sort of like technical terms that seem to be missing in your own language, that's where you have borrowing, like linguistically, so as to fill a gap. So you find, you know, Chinglish, you find Ganglish, Ewenglish, and in it, people will say, they'll be speaking Chi, but then they'll come to the word computer, and then they'll just say, okay, computer. And it's because they're feeling like, you know, there's a deficit, I need to fill in a gap that my language doesn't have. So to go to the Greek, they themselves were going to Kemet, and the word Seba, it has various translations. You have Seba, and it depends on the determinative, as to learn and to teach, learning and teaching, Sebait, That's when you talk about instructions of Ptahotep, instructions of so forth and so on. So they were seeing this as something to fill in a gap that they didn't have. So they looked at this term Seba, and then they brought it into their language, and it came out as the Sophia. So when you have all of these various Greek scholars are saying, you know, it's non-Hellenic, it's non-Attic, non-Greek, because they're filling in a gap for something that they felt like, if they had anything approximate to it, they felt like it's not up to it. There are words that can be used to render various technical terms nowadays in African languages, but again, when you look at the populace, people will tend to say, let's just borrow. Okay. Let's just use what's there, because that is the most, the word that can encapsulate the concept most is where we got it from, where we learned it from.
Thank you very much for this opportunity. Mine is what I learned from this video, and I think I've really learned a lot today. First of all, I think education is not really about teaching you mathematics, teaching you English, or teaching you science, but it's really about giving you the ability to think and your ability to gain wisdom. So we as Ghanaians or as people, we have to try and learn in order to gain wisdom. And the next thing I'll also add is about the preservation of our own culture and heritage. You see, what Dr. Obenga said was that during those old days, the Greeks, they were able to keep the pictures of their great people, Plato, Pythagoras, all these great people, they were able to store their images, they were able to store their stories up to now. That's where we're able to learn even the Pythagoras story that we have, and even to learn about these classics. So we have to preserve these important African leaders like Kwame Nkrumah, like all the presidents that we know that who are trying to forward the movement of Africa. We have to try and preserve them so that our children and the generations to come to also learn what we also have learned here. Thank you.
Okay. More hands?
So, really quickly, what's going around is a compilation of various quotes, and it has. So we were looking for the collected works of Plato, of Socrates, of Democritus, of Diodorus, Sicilus, and others. And this is what you have here. So it's from various sources, you can cross-reference them. But this is what the Greeks themselves, and you heard where Prof Emeritus Obenga said that the stolen legacy is really a modern thing, that the Greeks themselves weren't in on it, which is why they don't want you to actually read what they wrote, because they're trying to perpetrate a fraud quite intentionally to be like, oh, the Greeks started, but the Greeks weren't in on the scheme. It's like if you're trying to hustle someone and it's me and Nog gonna try to hustle you, and he doesn't know what I'm trying to do. Yeah, remember the other day, remember? He's like, what are you talking about? This is what you have going on with the Greeks. So when you actually read, on the first page, you see Plato. And we have an idea, and actually there was a professor who came here as a visiting professor. And he had the idea that democracy began with Democritus, right? And he thought that the idea of education for all started in Greece. So, you know, I gave him some quotes and it was very difficult for him to try to swallow what the Greeks themselves, you know, said about it, because what he had learned in school, a full professor, was that the Greeks originated all these ideas, whereas the world's first multi-genius, who knows that name? Imhotep. He was a commoner, the lowest rank of society, and he rose to the very highest rank in the society. What does that tell you about education, right? So in this one, you see Plato, And we're going to make more copies, so those who didn't have any will get to you. He says, one ought to declare then that the freeborn children, now he's saying only the freeborn children. So whereas in Kemet, the commoners, everyone could rise to this rank, he's saying, this is from the Greek perspective, and you can see how they're twisting it. One ought to declare then that the freeborn children should learn as much of these subjects as the innumerable crowd of children in Egypt learn along with their letters, right? So whereas in Kemet, innumerable are learning this, but for the Greeks, the freeborn, right? This is your liberal education. This is what Aikwe Amma, for those who were able to see his talk yesterday at the Brazil House, the idea is that only a small portion should get it, right? And the rest should be left out in the cold. And then in response, this is what Obeng was talking about. I was told quite lately of our condition in regard to this matter. I was utterly astounded myself. It seemed to me to be the condition of guzzling swine rather than of human beings. And I was ashamed not only of myself, but of all the Greek world. So in this, he's given the methodology by which African people teach, you know, in all these various aspects. So they'll make this into a counting game. They'll take you out to the field, and you're learning as you're doing sports. You're learning as you're drumming. You're learning all these various things. And then when he's asking, well, what about the Greek world? What are we doing? Ours is the condition of guzzling swine, right? So what is that telling you about Greeks? Let's look at, and then also who they were. As for this fellow, to say nothing of his dark skin, his protruding lips, and spindle shanks, his words came tumbling out in a heap, one on top of the other. It was Greek, of course, but the voice, the accent were of Egyptian born. So it's saying this is an African from Kemet who we're talking about. Black, they're giving the physical description. And there are others, but we'll open it back up as you are looking through, you know, more of these. Again, this is just a selection. You can go to dozens and dozens and dozens because the Greeks were very clear, right? It's just the modern day fraud where they're trying to make something where it wasn't. So let's come back out to the floor.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Valeria Earl. It's funny enough you're talking about this because I had a debate with my husband about this last night. And as much as we're learning about this is that I'm pretty sure it's not one or two black scholars that know about this, so why are we still letting them get away with it? What good is knowledge if we're not pushing for our history to be told correctly, because everybody's history on earth is being told correctly except for African history. Only will you come on the National History Channel in America, who everybody look at as almighty, all-powerful, all-knowing, and Egyptians are portrayed as either white people with blonde hair and blue eyes, or Arabs. They're not whitewashing in Chinese history. You don't see a white man play a Chinese man. You don't see a white man play an Indian man. You don't see an Arab play a Mexican, but yet it's still our history. And if we can show physical evidence, why are we not out in the streets and telling these history channels and telling everybody, stop lying? It's like it's a big secret that's known, but where is the action? Because we can sit here and talk all day, but I don't see no action being pushed. Or I still got kids in America who tell me Egypt is not in Africa. Where they say Egyptian news as if it's Middle Eastern news on the BBC. Like it's not even in Africa. Like we just non-existent.
So some of you know that recently we had a whole campaign about Gandhi Must Fall here. Is anyone aware of that? Right. So this is the idea that we're given Eurasian icons and false idols and all of these various things. Now, here we are in African studies, and there were some of us in African studies who were saying Gandhi must fall, right? He's calling you one degree removed from an animal. He's saying that you are savage, half heathen, so forth and so on. This is who is put up in front of our eyes as a hero. Then you have those of us who are against that. We saw his oppression of black people in the continent against the Zulus and against the black people in India. Here you see a quote on page 2 at the bottom. It says, the whole of India is traverses Diodorus, the bottom of page 2. The whole of India is traversed by rivers. As for the people of India, those in the south are like the Ethiopians in color, and they still are. Although they are like the rest in respect to countenance and hair, for on account of the humidity of the air, their hair does not curl, whereas those in the north are like the Egyptians, right? So again, this is, you know, what's going on. Now, we're saying that Gandhi must fall, but right here in African studies, you have a Gandhi must stand movement. I hope you are following me. So, you know, when we are actually getting out in the streets and, you know, we ended up getting close to 2,000 signatures, and they did a counter petition that got somewhere around 200 signatures. And this is despite all of the brainwashing about Gandhi, the brainwashing that we don't have our own heroes, that still was able to be the tally. So there are those of us who are, you know, promoting this, who are trying to let us know this is what the history is, this is what the truth is. But then we have others who look like us, who are fighting us tooth and nail to prevent that from going on. But that's why we're here, you know, today. That's why we're, you know, pushing this information, because we have to start somewhere. If you look around, you won't see very many other professors here. You won't see very many other lecturers here. And part of it is that they have already been taught that you did nothing, right? And they've built their entire castle on this sand, right? That you did nothing. And they're willing to just keep going along with that, as opposed to, you know, letting the truth be known. There are lots of challenges there, but there are those of us who are doing the work. Tomorrow we have a study group from Medunecha. We have some of our students who are here. So they're actually learning the indigenous language right here in African studies. Again, it's not, you know, a lot of people who want to learn that. We sent out the notice and we asked, is anyone amongst the faculty interested in learning that? Crickets, not a single one. They're used to learning that African people have never done anything, and they're comfortable with that. So what we're doing now is reaching out to the students who haven't gotten that so beaten into their head. And, you know, with that, we're trying to make it such that the next generation is going to already be on something entirely different.
Hello, everyone. My name is Yawasari. I'm here in the Institute. So yesterday, for those who were not at Kuyama's conversations, well, I'll do the unofficial thing by extending his greetings to you. But talking about action, he said something, as in that change can come very slowly, and that the important thing is that we create, like, as in something that is recognizable or a recognizable change. And that was something I wrote down. So in relation to action, it's something that came to mind. I'm also thinking that in relation to action, we could also be looking right into ourselves. In terms of, well, now, Professor Emeritus Obenga tells us that the origins of the so-called Greek philosophy is from Kemet, which basically is black, land of black people, or if you might call it what you want, Africa. So the point is that in doing well, once again, it comes to us as students, as whatever we do, and when we're doing our research, are we going to go back to the plagiarized text, or are we just going to go to the original text? I feel like that is like one really important like action that we should be doing. I mean, I'm not going to be going around watching some white history channels, because once I start doing the work, I know the truth. It's already in the text that was written for us. So one, I feel like it comes with, as in learning our own languages, be it Medunecha, be it Chi, Ewe, Zulu, Fanti, like whatever we want to learn. And learning the Dinkra symbols, all of these, they have like good some stuff, some good knowledgeable stuff that we should be accessing and using or utilizing in our everyday life. So from that, I feel like we can change. Yeah, pretty much. And I feel like once you've done that, and once I've done that, and once Akusi has done it, promise everyone like does that, it would all come together to create something that is really tangible and we can celebrate in, I don't know, like a few decades. Well, I'm very optimistic, so yeah, I would say. But yeah, I feel like the change comes from within us, and we should be working on ourselves right about now and those who are around us. That's what I would have.
Okay.
I'm inspired by your comments, what you just said, and it reminded me, as I listened to what you were saying, it reminded me when I was in school, no matter in my undergraduate program, my master's program, and both doctoral programs, no matter what topic the class was, no matter what topic the paper was, every opportunity I had, I looked for Black sources and Black scholars. Every opportunity. I'm sure my professors must have thought, if she just writes one more comedic this, ancient Nubia this, we're going to scream. But they couldn't say anything because I was sticking to the topic. I was writing APA style the way they required, and grammar and everything was correct. But every single source, I don't care if it had to do with art, I don't care if it had to do with farming, I don't care if it had to do with animal husbandry, I went far and wide to find a Black source and fill my citation section and resource section of my documents with as many Black scholars as I could possibly come up with. And I was even told at times to limit my page numbers. So in the spirit of what you're saying, I would say that that's one of the things that we can do, because it has a double function. We first educate ourselves in the process of doing that, because you go out of your way to find all of these Black sources, all of these African sources, and all of these different topics. But it also educates your readers. And I'm sure throughout my undergraduate and graduate education, I'm sure that my professors learned something, even though they weren't trying to learn something, but I'm sure that they learned something through all the sources that I had. So that for me as a student was one of the ways that I think I made one of the biggest impacts, both on myself personally as well as the people who had to read and grade my assignments.
I was at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and I was taking a course in African mythology with a professor by the name of Harold Choi. If you've ever seen the cover of the book called Yurugu, it looks just like that. For those who may not know, go look at that book up. So, or sort of like Yoda, I don't know if you've seen Star Wars, something like a mix between those two. So anyway, this is a course that's supposed to be on African mythology. And he hands us a packet on the first day, which is single space, 15 pages, and it's a bibliography, all sources. Not one single African source. In a subject on African mythology, this one is Joseph Campbell, this and this, you know, whatever. So I was very observant, I noticed that. So for my paper, I made it that I only cited African sources. Not a single European was in my final paper. And it was a seminar, so we gave the presentation, and my seminar was very, at that time I was more fiery than I am now.
Really?
Very calm. And as I was giving my presentation, I was looking at Yurugu, he was turning red, like this. And he was so angry that I was doing this, citing only African scholars, and that paper is the one that is just coming out in Contemporary Journal of African Studies, and it's the Dikenga theory of structure and worldview, looking at various African stories, looking at Akan, looking at Yoruba, and using an indigenous theory in order to explain the structure of these stories. The idea is that European theory say it starts like this, it goes up, then it comes down, and that's it.
Whereas Africans have an idea the sun rises and then it sets and then it rises again. Just because you can't see the sun doesn't mean it doesn't exist anymore. So I'm dealing with, well, what's going on here, right? Psychologically, what's going on structurally as it's a seed that germinates another idea for another story or the same story. So looking at this type of thing. So these are the things that we can do. He did not like that paper at all. And I didn't expect him to like it, but now I'm publishing the paper, right? So these are the things that we can do in resistance.
I think we need to, you know, give a round of applause. No, no, there was no one yet. I thought it was.
Okay, my name is Prof Emeritus, and I'm happy I'm here today. When I was listening to our brother Théophile Obenga, he made us understand that Plato said something. He said, the chemist people educated the masses, everybody, but then for the Greeks, it was supposed to be for those who were born free or a minimum number of people. The question I'm asking is, at this time in our country, it looks like education is becoming so expensive and brilliant children are unable to go because their parents are unable to afford. What can we do to make sure that we send education to these young people and bring them out so that we can become like the former African people?
What can we do to make sure that education doesn't get more expensive? In fact, that it gets cheaper so we can take it, share it around.
I want to bring in some of our graduate students. When they thought I was in the man, I paid 400 Ghana CDs. And they saw my passport, they charged me $4,000. I was getting my same salary right here in Ghana. But what I want to do, I want some of our grad students. We have a grad assistant, grad student all-star team. That's Yawa Sare Kam, Nana Kosia. I want you all to be part of the conversation. These are the future generation who are going to also be taking this over, so we have our IES grad student all-star team. I want you all to field some of these. Any thoughts on that? Also, you know that the Peace Was Fall movement is going on in South Africa. That's one thing to think about, but let's get some of your ideas on this.
Pass it on first one, Kosiat.
Okay. Well, basically for me, one thing that comes to mind was, once again, I'll refer to the discussion with Aikuyama yesterday, and he did mention that when people talk about Kemet, we tend to talk about kings and queens and all of that, but then, you know, to have a king, you must have a slave or, you know, a commoner and all of that. To have a queen, you must have a commoner. So basically, like, our society right now is built on a caste system, you know. So, like, there is the idea that we should all be free, we should all be liberal, but those who are saying that we should be liberal, at the end of the day, where do they take their kids to? Really expensive schools and all of that. Now, what that creates is that the impression that there are some people who are better than the others and all of that, you know, it creates that caste system again. Well, for fees to fall, for everything to fall, I think I was really siding with him when he mentioned the principles of like Ma'at, whereby basically that's true justice, reciprocity, balance, order, harmony. So basically, like, everything is equal, everybody enjoys whatever we enjoy, you know, like all of that. Because there is so much in here, I feel there is, we've got like so much in here that education, like to teach someone about themselves, about their spirituality, about, you know, like to make people aware, like, we do not need to be paying this ridiculous, like, sums of money. Like, it just doesn't make sense, you know. It creates this privilege once again. So for me, it's a hefty, like, job. It's really big in terms of, one, we've got to destroy our political system as we have it now. The proponents of democracy, we always cite Lincoln, but I mean, he didn't believe that we should all be like represented because, well, he thought that, you know, we were not of equal stand. So pretty much I feel like we should start by demolishing all of that, you know, language as well. Like, there is a lot to be done, to be honest, but eventually when we return back to my art, when we return back to who we were, what we were, and also add on to it, all of these would happen. I would say, yeah, like the level would be there and would go back to what we were, that is in the Nile Valley civilization or pre-dynastic Egypt.
Hi everyone, I'm Akosia Hansen and I'm one of Dr. Nambon's students. And what I'll say about the feast was for, I work in media, I work at YFM and vice at one. And so the argument on the media side was fiery. People didn't understand how Gandhi could be that person. And what you saw was there were lots of really respected radio personalities who run like morning show arguments about why the Gandhi Must Fall movement is nonsensical and it's radical and it's Gandhi who stood for peace. They just knew that one script. And what I learned from it was this is information that they've been programmed with all their lives. It's like someone coming to tell you that, oh, your name all along has not been Bernard, you know, and so this is now your name. Your name is actually Kofi. And I find a lot of Ghanaians, it's really, really, not Ghanaians, the world, it's really, really, really difficult to erase that previous knowledge that has been put in your head. So even if you get the truth, it's not as simple as, oh, now this is the truth, I'm going to take it. No, it's let me find ways to make this falsity logical to me. So that was a raging argument on the media side. And on the media side, they made, of course, the intellectuals who are behind it seem mad and gaga, and they're too into their books, so they're not in touch with reality. And finding ways to slander some of the intellectuals behind the Gandhi Must Fall. So how am I wrapping up?
However you want to do it.
Yeah, so basically that was aside from media. So me as a media person now studying all of this, a lot of these things I came to find out just last year in Dr. Cameron's class and a few other classes. I have to start to try to take the initiative to push in the media the way I can. I must say it's not an easy thing. There are several times, even personal issues, I've been blocked and told to shut up about it. We don't want this in this space. So it means creating new media spaces. And now there's so many ways to have your own show and have your own real content without someone who owns a radio station or TV station telling you what to do. There are podcasts, there's YouTube. And so those are avenues I'm personally looking at for next year, and I'll definitely be involved with some of you. Thanks.
Yeah, okay. I just have something in relation to Kwame's question about peace. And I'm going to borrow one of Akosia's thoughts about creating new spaces and creating alternatives. Because as things stand, if you look at our educational trajectory, when my father used to tell me stories about when he was here in university, they had a steward who was standing in front of the dining hall. And when they had visitors, any time of the day they had visitors, all they had to do was to walk the visitor to the dining hall. They'll be ushered in by the steward, and they'll be fed whatever they wanted to eat, whatever they wanted to drink. All right? In addition to that, they were receiving allowances for being in school. As we speak today, all of these things are gone. And when you look at where we are now, from where we started, it looks like it's only going to get worse. When I came to graduate school, I know how much I paid. Those in graduate school currently are paying more than 300-400% what I paid. And I can only imagine what those who are undergraduates now will be paying when they get here. And some years back, at Commonwealth Hall, students could mobilize and resist the authorities with some of their policies, okay? Today, it seems that that spirit of resistance is gone. So the authorities have a free way. So if they feel they are going to increase your fees 300%, they are going to do it because there's no resistance. Yeah. You don't have student leaders. Once they go and sit up there, I can't find an easier expression, but they are all shrink. All right? So what do they do? Everything is pushed down their throat. Meanwhile, every year they campaign, they are put into office. Yet what happens? So maybe when the students finally realize that their backs have been broken, that's when you might see something like a resistance on this campus. But for now, if I have even pushed to offer a solution about how to make education cheaper, I'm thinking more like let's create newer spaces, okay? Because so far as paid education or certified education is concerned, it looks like I'm hoping to be told tomorrow that I was wrong, but it looks like we have lost the battle, and it's only going to get worse. All right. So.
You know, I learned recently that there's this thing called susu here in Ghana. And I think we need to borrow from that when it comes to education and what people cannot afford, so that if 10 people can only afford 1/10 of the school tuition, that they take among the 10 of them what will equal one tuition, buy their own supplies, and homeschool their own children. Because what we're looking for is not necessarily letter grade progression when we think about educating our children. What we're looking for is knowledge and competencies. And my four children all participated in the highly gifted and talented program in Denver Public Schools, and I can assure you that I supplemented their education as if they were homeschooled. Because even in that kind of a program, it was inadequate for what I wanted them to know and their proficiency and their level of reading and science and math competencies and art competencies. So I supplemented it heavily. And that was the fact that they were in that program. So when I think about your question and what can people do who cannot afford it, I would say that groups of people need to get together and buy a curriculum and then begin to teach each other, not just only for the curriculum, but above and beyond the curriculum, because children can learn that. And I would also encourage you to say that children who are not able to go to the school are not necessarily unfortunate because of the content is so poor and misleading and will miseducate them. It may actually be a blessing in disguise.
What I'm gonna say is probably gonna seem very radical, but that's me, so. I think it goes a little bit deeper. In order for y'all to change y'all school fees, y'all need to change y'all education system. Y'all done put y'all faith in an illusion. Let me give you a fact. I do my degree online, and I read today that about, I might be wrong, but about 25% of Americans can't read. Take that in. We get free education. We have internet access. We get free libraries, not just in our school, in our neighborhoods. Most American adults read on a fifth grade level. Most high school students can't even read. And I noticed, I witnessed this with my own eyes. Adults who can't even say philosophy, let alone know what the word means. We're talking about, how can we lower the school fees? Why are we even paying for a watered-down education on somebody else's terms? Why do y'all have a British education in Ghana? I mean, nobody questions that, nobody asks that. Why is it that American and European standards are the way when we're looking at they stole their standards from us and then backwards? So in order to stop the expensive and money is also another illusion. It's just paper. The only thing they give it value is your opinion in it.
And that's the honest to God truth. Because back in America, you used to be able to turn in your money for gold. That stopped years ago. So your money is just paper. So now you're forcing your kids, you're going out there doing everything you can to put your kids in this education system, which don't even educate them, tell them that they're nothing, oh, you're something until you reach our standards. And then you're going out there fighting for a piece of paper that when those who make it decide that it's no longer valuable, what you're gonna kill for it in? What you're gonna put your kids in school then for it in? Because we're all saying go to school so you can make more paper. Which, if you don't know, your paper, your money, isn't even printed in Ghana. It's printed in America. Mm-hmm. So to abolish these high school fees, take your faith out of these systems and get back to what you knew.
Okay, everyone who has a pen and paper. Write down this website. abibifahundie.org. It's spelled just like how it sounds. Abibifahundie, that's abibifahundie.org. And what this is a collective of parents who have come together. We all homeschool our children, right? So at Legon Botanical Gardens, we have where we come together to do that collectively. We understood very clearly, we never put our faith in that system. To send your children to any, first we have to question even the paradigm of who told you as normal or natural to send your child to some stranger that you don't know, right? So that's one, to send your children there, especially seeing the effects of it. I teach here at the university, and when I ask students, do they know anything about Africa, they know close to zero. When I ask them anything about Europe, they know all. Do we want to test that? Julius Caesar, do we know the name? Napoleon, do we know the name? Einstein, do we know the name? Shakespeare, do we know the name? Mm-hmm. Now let's come to ours. Mary Carey, do we know the name? Have we read the instructions to Mary Carey? Kagimni, do we know the name? Have we read the instructions of Kagimni? Harjadef, have we read that? Potahotep, Sanhat, have we read that? Right? So these are the things that, you know, very few of us have even heard of, much less have read. So having seen that, I said it would be child abuse for me to send my children into that same type of thing, right? It would be, and on their part, it's educational malpractice. You know, you can sue a doctor for malpractice, medical malpractice. This is a concept my father has, educational malpractice, right? So just saying all that to say there are those who are actually doing this. This isn't theoretical that, yes, we should do this, but we're not doing it. I went to a conference in South Africa where they were talking about using African languages, mother tongue education, all of these things. It's a very, you know, important subject, especially there. And then someone in the room said, how many of you teach your children in your own language? My hand was the only hand that went up in a whole room of people who are scholars on mother tongue education. How many people speak to your children in your language? How many of you send your children to schools where they teach in mother tongue? No hands other than my own. All continental Africans, all of them supposedly know their language, but not a one. I stay at Hacho, four families, I'm the only one who speaks to my children in African languages, and I'm the only one who is not born on the continent. So I speak to my children in Chi, in Yoruba, in Wolof. I teach, so at abibifahundie.org, we teach Medu Necha in Chi, We teach mathematics, geometry, everything, botany, all of this in Chi. And the videos are online if you want to see them, right? So these are the things that we're talking about. It's not a purely theoretical thing, right? And what we do in terms of, to come to your point about the fees, those parents who contribute, who come, they pay zero, right? Whatever your skill is, whatever you know, that's what you bring to the table and you pay zero. Those who want to do stop, drop, and roll, just drop the child and roll on out, then they pay something, but it's much less than all of your Lincolns and GIS and all these other things. It's in Ghana Cedis one and not in dollars or pounds or whatever they're charging there. But again, this is what we're talking about, creating spaces, and it has to be beyond the rhetoric of talking and saying, let's do this. That's what Ike Bayama, he even looks at me in African Studies, he's like, what are you doing in African Studies? Create your own thing. But I read in his book, he said, in African Studies, we should stop going to our village and make our thesis about my grandma's lullabies, right? He said that we should be teaching Medunecha in African Studies. So I read that, I said, okay. We have our study group, we meet tomorrow at 1 p.m. How many of you will be there? To learn our own indigenous writing, our own indigenous texts. If not, you've cut yourself off from the majority of human history. From the majority of human history, you don't know anything about it. Math, medicine, science. So again, rather than what we're doing right now, and I'll close on this and let it go back out to the floor, what I'm doing right now is I'm mopping up the floor instead of turning off the tap. The tap is that all of you are being manufactured to be anti-Africans, right? And what I'm doing is, here I see another deluge coming through, I'm just trying to mop up the floor. Now what we have to do is get a different flow coming, where others are coming through already being African, as opposed to I'm trying to reverse the effects of anti-education, diseducation, and miseducation. So we start from the children and we take them from there, and we'll see what they will do.
Yeah, well, as I shook the mic there, I would also love for us to, right now, let's nurture some ideas and stuff. So if you've got like a really cool idea, you know, as to how we can turn up the tap, I think we should. Something came to mind today whereby I'm like, I was trying to talk to a friend who is from, she speaks Luganda. Yeah, like, so she speaks Luganda, and I was trying to say something to her, but I really wanted to say it to her in Luganda. I'm like, yo, why don't I know her language? So what I did was, this was an idea I got from yesterday's conversations again, whereby Aisha Haruna has used like Excel to show us a chronology of text, like from as far back as 4,000, showing you like which ones came first. And you see that most of these earliest documents were from Africa. So pretty much like the idea that came to me was that using the same Excel sheet, I created, you know, what do you call it? I'm still creating it. Like using, so I've created spaces for almost every language in Africa, and then, like I see someone who is from anywhere. I'm like, how do you say this in Ewe? You know, they tell me I just slotted in at the end, you know, it's all in line. But I feel like there's something that's not one person's journey, but I would take like, you know, I don't know, the whole collective lot. So in time, I'll just send it out and people can also fill in their spaces. But I feel like this is like one way that we can be, I don't know, creating some spaces whereby we get to learn about ourselves. So yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. What I think we can do to also promote the tap is also, after they've taught you how to speak the African language, we have to practice. So where do we practice? You have to get a place where you will keep books, you will keep whatever you've produced, like a library or like a museum, so that we can be able to get access to this information. Because if they teach you how to write in Yoruba, how to write Chi, or how to read, and at the end of the day, you don't go to practice. You don't get information to practice. I don't think it will be able to last longer as you want. So we should have that lifelong learning activity too, so that we can pass on this information.
basically learned my English from reading. I wasn't really good at the language initially. Was my house, we don't normally speak the language. My father is very good at the English. He teaches in the subject, so he's very good. But my mom is she leans more towards the sense of the local language, the Gantry and the Chipmunk language. So for me, learning Chi actually had more of a boost. When I got my hands on Chi books, when I was coming up in primary school, class 2, 3, 4, 5, when I was reading the Ghanaian language, the Chi account language, that's when my proficiency in Chi actually became something, because in the house, we don't really speak Chi, like what Doc said, it's more like Chi English. It's a mix with English and some Chi words. And my folks are not really Akan, so that makes us worse than what others will find in most places here. So I think that it would be very good if we get more like African language books like printed out and like with much easier access. Because I think reading actually helps build one's language and knowledge of self. Maybe we could print more books in our languages, write in them. It's quite easy. It would be very easy for us to change things around. It starts here. And to get it here, you must see it. I don't know how to say it. You must read the work of others, experience what's actually going on. But what I'm trying to say is that it must first happen here for it to happen in your surroundings. And to get it here, you must actually get the information from somewhere. And that's like the basic principle of almost everything here. Happening to the soul realm and the physical realm. It's as simple as that. So let's get something.
Hi, I'm Benaji Mfua. And just kind of piggybacking on what you were talking about, just the idea of creating more materials in local languages, what comes to mind for me is not just in the context of language, but... Sorry, guys. My mom's calling me. Anyway, I think about the need to kind of take learning outside of the academy, like we've been talking about, but in innovative ways that engage young learners. For instance, I make puppets in my spare time when I'm not writing my dissertation. And for me, initially, it's something that started when I had my child. I found it a way to engage him, in learning. And I think part of our issue in terms of kind of decolonizing and democratizing the learning enterprise is also that if we look outside of the academy, look on our TV, we don't necessarily see learning programs and things of that nature for children that reflect our culture. So, I mean, now you do have some great work coming out of even Nigeria, the Bino and Fino, and some other kind of shows that are reflecting African realities. But I do think that some of the work that a lot of us should be doing as scholars is thinking about how to produce products that are accessible to young people and that engage them, but also that reflect, our heritage, that reflect some vision of an African future that is Pan-African, is informative of, just African reality in general. So I think that's something to think about. Books are great, books are great. I do think there should be more books produced, but I do think that we should think about the media, think about the images that our children are seeing. Yeah.
Again, on education and then development of our local language, I happen to be a class one teacher, and there was this national program, which was then NALAP, National Language and Literacy Aspiration Program. So because of that, the policy was that we supposed to use the local language to teach from KG1 to primary 3. Then I heard on radio, bankers, economists were talking, when our kids going to learn to speak English and so on. I personally took it on to teach in my school. And when I started, my head teacher was like, what is this guy doing? And then teacher who was teaching in class 2 was, this guy is spoiling the kids for me, because you know, when you able to do this work. So all these things happened. I didn't mind them. I did it for 2 things. Then there was a district program. They decided to choose my class. I sent them, you had a program, and the district director, everybody was like, they go to this school, they say, go to Instagram office and go and see what you're doing there. And so forth. So I argue that the kids have a language from the house. He knows the sun in the summer as area. So if I use that language to teach him natural science, he gets the concept better than speaking the English language. And at the end of it, people became like, oh, this guy is this guy. But unfortunately, I graded myself and they said I had to leave the business school to a different place because the course content demand ought to have been taught in senior high school rather than being a business school, so I had to leave. So I want to suggest that let's use this platform to support government policy that calls for the indigenization of some of these things. Because other than that, some people who speak nice English, they did in economics before and so on, they went to have students so come and speak and they talk them down. And so we let everything go down to the drain.
Yeah, a quick one too, just before I forget. So this morning, so I talked to like Boris Campbell, who is the Kwame Nkrumah chair here, and it's also got to do with the idea of having like a book club whereby we can, you know, study some books and have like, actually have a study group. So basically like the first book is going to be his book, Rasta Resistance, which he wrote some time ago. And definitely we're all going to like read that and we'll come together and discuss with him present. So if you're also interested, you could give me a shout out. When? No, when has not been decided yet, so it's now and then. Yeah, but this also goes to like what's, you know, I mean, if you have something cool, you know, something, creating new spaces and all of that, please do let us know so that we can connect and take this conversation out outside of here. Yeah.
Okay, does anyone here have an Android phone? It may also be, some of these may also be on iPhone, so you can search. But there are people who have developed apps for various African languages and African information. So there's one called Yoruba 101, and it's aimed at children, right? So you can look at that one. There's another one called Easy Wolof, you know, the major language of Senegal. There's Chi 101, Igbo 101. There's hieroglyph flashcards. Egyptian Senet. Senet was a board game, the forerunner to what we now know as chess. Easy Chi. So, you know, some of these things that we're talking about, they need to be done. There are people who had the idea a while ago and they've actually done it. There's also Abibitumi Kasa. I don't know if anyone knows of that site, but it's a resource for every single thing under the sun dealing with Africa, African languages, African anything. Now, part of our challenge is that many of us boycott anything made by African people, either intentionally or unintentionally. We say if it's not owned by a white so-called Jew named Mark Zuckerberg, we will not participate. Whether that's Facebook, whether that's WhatsApp, we refuse to support anyone black. But all of these things that we're saying, it would be a good idea if someone aimed things towards the children, that's been done, right? So when I'm driving, I'll hand my phone back to my daughter and I'll tell her, study her Medunecha. And it's a game, it's a flashcard. She clicks this one, you know, it smiles at her, she clicks that one. There's one where you go through a household and it shows you the names, you press on it and shows you the names of everything in Medunecha. There's one that we use in our school, Abibu, which is Proverbs. And it gives you a random proverb in Chi, then it gives you the translation. So all of these are aimed at, you know, children. There are others that are aimed at adults. So we have RSS feeds on a Bibitumi Kasa, whereas news and Wolof, so you can listen to everything that's going on in the world and do it in Wolof. You can do the same thing in Chi. You can do the same thing in Yoruba. You can do the same thing in various African languages. So again, as we are sitting on Facebook liking something, that is a principle of physics that two things can't be in the same space at the same time, right? So every time you're spending supporting Eurasians is time that you're not spending supporting Africans who are doing all these great ideas that we're saying should be done, right? So let's think about that. Let's see how we can just in the Play Store or in the App Store, type in the name of the language you're interested in, and you'll find their apps for children, you'll find their books for children. On Abibi Tumikasa, over 100,000 resources, PDFs, videos, songs, every single medium you can imagine, right? So let's support those who are already doing the work. I also wanted to share a quote, and I'll paraphrase it from what I can remember. And it's, they must find it difficult, those who accept authority as truth instead of those who accept truth as authority. Let me come again. They must find it difficult, those who accept authority as truth instead of accepting truth as authority. So these are people, you can give them the quotes, you can read it in Greek to them, but to them the Greeks are the first because the authority said that. To them, you can give them the quotes from Gandhi, early life, late life, but Gandhi is about peace, and there's something cognitive dissonance that will not allow them to think anything other than what authority has told them. Nelson Mandela said Gandhi was good, therefore. Now, how much detailed research was Mandela doing in Robben Island prison? Right? So these are the things that we don't think about, but we just say, here's an authority, he said, whereas you yourself can read it. We spoke in one of my classes, academic writing, where I asked people, is Europe a continent? Is Europe a continent? I'll ask you as well. Is Europe a continent? That's what makes. If you want to get the answer right on your test, it better be. But by all definitions, Europe is no more a continent than West Africa is a continent. The western part of one landmass called Eurasia, the western part of a landmass called Africa, right? But again, authority has told us it's a continent. Should the map be south up or north up? The first map in the history of all human beings, what they call the Turin Papyrus map, named after the place where they stole it and took it to, is a south up map. All of the maps in Kemet were south up maps. The word for east, Yabit, was the same word for left. That means Somalia, that's in the east, is the sun is rising on your left. Imenet, the word for west, was the same word for right. So picture Dakar, Ghana, all West Africa is on your right. Upper is southern, lower is northern. Now if I show you a map, you'll say, why is your map upside down? But if we're stuck in a 500-year box, and we think the way it is now is the way it's always been. Today I asked my students, is it universal to think black is bad? They said, yes, it's universal. And one said, I don't think it's universal. I said, can you give me an example that shows it's not universal? He said, no. He just had a feeling. So I cited in the Songhai language, the word bibi is black, and everything beautiful, powerful, strong is black. When they want to say the sun is powerful, why need bibi? The black sun. When they want to say pure water, Hari Bibi, black water. When they want to say fertile soil, Sadiza Bibi. Anything that's good is black in that language. In Kemet, the word for perfection and completion was Kem, right? Because when you keep adding colors, when you get complete, when you get perfect, is when it's finally black. Mm-hmm. The deities were represented as black, also. If you go to India, Marco Polo said, oh, they have an interesting thing where all the deities are black, all the demons are white in India, right? If you look at the black Madonna and child all throughout Europe, all of them are black. And then Alexander VI said, we're white, why are we worshiping images of blacks? Let's arbitrarily decide to make them white. But if we are lost to that whole chronology of texts, all those chronology of sources, will think that all that's going on here in the last 500 years is all there's ever been. And even if you have something in your heart that tells you it's not true, you don't have any information, because all you've studied is what they've told you. Mm. Let's open it back up to the floor.
They're now telling you that in the dead of winter, that's the beginning of the year, and that is not true. Winter, the beginning of the year, starts at spring, which is the spring equinox, which was supposed to be the Easter. Most people don't even know why y'all celebrate Easter. Easter was the beginning, the rebirth, if you are Christian. And it's not a Christian concept, because you can find the mother, the child, Isis and Horus on Egyptian temples 2,000 years before Christianity. Just so y'all know, that's why y'all say amen in reference to Amen Ra. Not a Christian, but Egyptian or Kemet. The telling of time, a lot of things have been changed within the last 500 years. Time, the way we worship our deities, but what they don't tell you is that the Pope today still bowed down to a black woman and a black child. And it has been documented that the Pope today still worship a graven image, by the way, bowed down to a black Madonna and a black child. And what's funny enough is that this is on Google. It's not found in a book in some library with dust on it. It's right on your phone. How many of us use our phones for that? No, right, one, maybe two, three. Can I get 5, 6, 7, 8? No, we Twittering and then taking Snapchat, Facebook. So the thing is that with black people, it's a saying that if you don't want a black man to know something, put it in a book. Well, nowadays, if you don't want a black man to know something, put it in African history. Because we definitely don't seem like we want to know that when it's right here. So one thing I encourage people to do, and I'm not just all talk, I wrote my senior exit project at a high school on Willie Lynch, which I'm sure I will hope at least one person know. Not the brother from America, but at least one person from Africa will know who Willie Lynch is, which is the reason why black people in America are in the condition that they're in today. We need to be challenged to look up these things, because when you change time, time went along with how we even worshiped. We have been so thrown off on even how we worship because they changed something like time. So, you know, basically the reason why I'm saying this is that if you research what has happened in the last 500 years and what's happening today, and then you'll understand a bit more of why we are in the condition, that we are in. And that research doesn't necessarily mean you have to leave the house. It's just a matter of actually Googling it.
Okay. I think she deserves a lot. Okay. All right, y'all, it seems so after y'all, we'll ask Dr. Kambon to give us, someone else wants to speak after y'all? Okay, let me take him, then I come to you.
Thank you very much for this opportunity. So two words, brilliant. I'm regretful for having a white name. And I hope to change it very soon.
Yeah, you should. You should change it soon.
I thank my brother for using the word they have the shrinked balls. But I don't even think they have the balls that are even shrinked. They don't even have the balls, our leaders. I just can't tell why African leaders can't come together and then unite. And I can say for fact that if Kwame Nkrumah should wake up today, if Lumumba should wake up today, if just these guys should just wake up, I don't know, like, what's happening to these kids that we fought for? Like, they can't just get it. I don't know, like, maybe they have to, like, put. Now, let me get to this also, like, the religious something that we are being forced to. I was telling one of my roommates, more of my people that come with, like, religion is what has made us so thoughtless. Like, we just don't know what to do because we're told that we don't have any concern on this planet that we'll get to paradise one day, we'll get to heaven one day. So we are not concerned about what happens to us on this planet. We're not concerned about brotherly love, development, actualization, real education. Like, there's just a whole lot of things. Let me touch on the money system that my sister also said. It's paper. It's not just paper now, it's digitized. With a click of a button, madam, master, you've lost your money. Like, it's over for you. It's then times that you have paper that, like, you can keep it in your room. Now you go to, like, mobile money, ATM, Visa card, MasterCard, debit card, credit card. You are just finished with just a click of a button, you are done. Like, you can't just do anything. I was telling my friends that, like, the white man came to Africa, they claim they are here to tell us what? The gospel. They came, and then they ended with enslavement, slavery. In which way can we get out of this slavery? The only way is if we understand the mindset of the, or the philosophy of the religion they came with, then we can rebel against this religion and then set ourselves free. And they were like, no way. I said, I don't believe in the Bible. Hey, like, I know I'm reading one book now. Like, if you can have, like, the ultimate canon of knowledge by this guy, Alvin Watt Kuhn. And he's also reading, like, Who is the King of Glory? It's a different story from Jesus, from, like, Horus, Isis, and then the whole thing is a mythology coming from the Greek side and then has been, like, surrounded around a figure, Jesus, and then you've been, like, put your thinking, you surrender yourself to such a figure in order to save you. So you don't think about saving yourself, like, you can't free yourself because, like, you've surrendered every of your privilege, every of, like, your thinking to a figure to save you. So, like, you can't do anything. Like, when you ask people to do something and they tell you, like, let's pray. I don't have anything against prayer. But what sort of, how has prayer, like, changed our thought? How has prayer crippled our thinking, our rational thinking? I bet you can go to a Christian church today. A Muslim can enter into a Christian church today. Let me just know, like, I just don't believe in the religion thing, but, like, say that Christianity, enter into a Christian room today, then take a gun and shoot every Christian. Ask Christians to go back and retaliate, they will not. So let's pray. God, like, save us. But let a Christian go into a mosque and then shoot one Muslim, and then you see the retaliation. You just see the retaliation. Like, Christianity has crippled our thinking. Like, we just don't think any longer.
Yeah.
And then I hope this guy's book, Kwame Nkrumah's Conscience System, reach all of us. I hope it's a recommended book for secondary school students to read. It's just going to, like, your conscience, awakened conscience. I entered the Palm Library and I saw just that book one, and then things that I prayed to get me that book. Maybe the African studies might have it and abandon, but the Palm Library takes the librarian to get me that one. I'm a math and star student, but I just love Africa. and then I'm just into Africa. So I followed one of my brothers, like, come, and then I hope to be coming often and often.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, I want to lend my voice to what you just said. I don't say this very often, so if you repeat it, I'll deny it. But I used to be married to a Baptist minister. I was with him for 21 years. I was a pastor's wife, first lady. Yes, scary but true. Ordained and all of that. And from personal experience, being heavily involved in the doctrine of that in the background, I mean, going about as deep as you can get, I'm telling you, in addition to what your brother just said, that it really does dumb down and infects your capacity to think normally and to think naturally. One of the things that it does that is so insidious is that it causes you to externalize your divinity, which is internal. And like a child, you'll begin to think that God is up there, which totally does not make sense with the teaching, in its own teaching of an omnipresent God. So if God is omnipresent, why, how is God up here and I'm here? That doesn't even make sense, it doesn't even add up. But it's full of this type of teaching that actually dumbs you down. Not only in terms of its dogma, but it dumbs you down in terms of its politics. I'll give you an example. I used to say to my children when they were coming up, when they were young, that you could say just about anything to me, but you have to choose your words careful. You can't talk to me anyway. You can ask me just about anything. Sometimes I'll tell you none of your business, but you just have to be careful how you talk to me. But yet in the politics of Christianity, you cannot ask certain questions because you will be seen as a heretic. Again, in that politic, what type of divinity, what type of divine entity would not want you to know something? What type of a divine entity would not want you to know the origin of the Christian Bible and how it has been adulterated and bastardized? Why would God not want you to know that? That doesn't even make sense. So there are numerous ways in which the system is dumbing you down. And if it was as spirit-led and of God as people are letting on, there would be hordes of missionaries coming over here saying, take the white guy down, take him down, that is not Jesus. They would be doing all manner of things like that, led by the Spirit and the truth of God, and yet that is not happening. It doesn't make sense. Why would God not want you to be smart? This is not making any sense. Do you want your children to be smart? Well, then how are you, being the beings that you are, you want your children to be smart, but God doesn't want you to be smart. That doesn't even make sense. So I just wanted to lend my voice with yours and give credence to the fact that this, in fact, is something that is very insidious. And I know from personal experience that people have made you to believe down to your bone marrow that if you go against this, you are in danger of hellfire eternally. And I'm telling you, you are not. It is a fail-safe, a psychological fail-safe that is put in place to keep you where you are. That's all it is. It is a psychological fail-safe. It is a psychological virus that is put in place to keep you where you are. Because if you wake up, you are a sleeping giant to be reckoned with. And people don't want a strong enemy, they want a weak one. So I just want to lend my voice to the brother, because I know a lot of times here in Ghana, when you question these things, people tend to, because a whole lot of people aren't saying it, it must not be true, or a certain person is saying it, it must not be true. And it's easy to discount them. But I'm telling you, as a former pastor's wife, former Sunday school superintendent, former person who was ordained, a former person who has been all of this neck deep and then some, it is not what you think it is.
This is going to be the last time y'all hear from me. I'm not going to take over the mic again, but please. Let's forget the dogma. Let's go on some historical facts. The first slave ship that came here was called Jesus. That should have been number one questioning. The black slaves, they don't tell y'all what happened to us when we got over there. They just make it seem like we got over there and it was McDonald's. We was going through drive-through lines. We was happy and everything. No, we were not. We were beat, raped. And just so you know, the number one people who were raped were the men.
Hello.
Not the women and girls. It were the men and boys. Because it psychologically damaged a man to be raped. And they knew that it was right. It's called buck busting, or breaking the buck. And when you rape a man, you can psychologically break him down. And because men were above women, once you bring the man down, you bring the woman down, you bring the children down, you bring the entire nation, the people down. We were stripped of our language, of our culture. We couldn't even, the whole system of cutting off your hair was because you ain't allowed to have this hair on your head. Because we was just doing all these different styles. No. And just so you know, we were literally, we got so cold with them braids that we literally could draw maps in our braids and let another person see it and knew a map how to get to somewhere. They made us cut off our hair. But the one thing they allowed us to do was to keep Christianity. We was allowed to be taught about Jesus. And what they taught you was that Jesus said you were supposed to be a slave. Now, I'll pay somebody right now 50 CDs if you can find me in the Bible where it says that when you die, you go to heaven. Pick up a Bible. You got it on your phone. Show me where it says in the Bible that when man die, you go to heaven or you go to hell. I don't see nobody reaching because you can't find it. I know that it hurts. I know that somebody think that when we step outside, lightning's going to strike us. We're going to get hit by a chocho tonight. Or something else. But it's not crazy. Just stop and question it. Why are we worshiping a white man? That is not the Jesus. His name is not even Jesus. His name is Yeshua. There is no J in the Hebrew language. Or any of the ancient African languages for that. If I'm wrong, please correct me. There is no J. It was Y. And that's how we even interpret it now, because we're using English letters to interpret another language. His name is Joshua. He was a black man. He was definitely not a white man. That picture that y'all see, that people bowing down to, crying to, is a picture of Michelangelo's uncle, which is a known fact. It might sound crazy, it might sound scary, but why is it that you take a people of everything, but then you let them keep a religion? Which a religion is supposed to empower you. Because it was never meant to empower you. It was meant to keep you down. And it's like, that's the one thing. If we want to talk about how to become more African, then we need to throw that off. Even if you don't want to let it go, at least paint him black. I mean, at least paint the man black. Goodness gracious, you bow down to a white man, a picture at that. And then you think all of a sudden they lying to you, talking about bring your money, tithes and offerings. Tithes and offerings was given to the children of Israel, the Levites, because they didn't have a portion in Israel. And even after a certain time, they said, stop bringing those tithes and offerings. We don't need it anymore. It's a problem for me because when I came to Africa, I didn't expect to see this. We in America, like, you know, we want to go back home. And then we see girls with long blonde weaves. Y'all bleaching your skin. Oh, no, we don't do that over there. You crazy if you bleaching your skin. And then we see people, oh, I want a white husband because, you know, I want fair babies.
Yeah.
What?
Oh, yeah.
You want fair babies. So I want a white man. Oh, white women are better. It's like everything that's not African down to the person we are praying to is acceptable. But when we talk about a black Jesus, or let's forget about that whole system, because like I said, go to Egypt. It's written on the walls. So you're going to tell me something that was there for 2,000 years prior to Christianity, now all of a sudden you're going to tell me this is a lie? But those other things that's written on the wall isn't a lie. I'm just really asking people to wake up because I'm disappointed in Africa I came to meet.
Oh.
I'm just disappointed because it's like, I'm thinking about Africa. I'm pretty sure you was probably disappointed when you first got here and you saw how it was. It's like,
back in 2000, I cried.
Because this is an Africa that we know we trying to get back, and we starting to see that we coming back, and it's like, I don't think some of y'all realize what colonization did to y'all. We know we were slaves. Do y'all know y'all was colonized? Because it's like, wake up, people. So that's all I'm going to say. I'm not going to hold the mic. I got to get out of here. My husband is calling me, but this is my first time being here. Actually, I've never even been to the University of Ghana. This will not be the last time I'm here. I hope that everybody here takes something from this. Please don't be offended. Just look it up. Seriously, just look it up.
Then yeah, and don't then. Can we close for now?
About the truth about Christianity, quote unquote. I've sat down with certain ministers at the SDA Church, where my father is. I've tried, having a certain dialogue with them, talking to them about the truth of things. They seem to be very scholarly, so I thought maybe they would be more accepting of what I had to bring. So I told them to go read on the origins of Christianity and what the Bible is, how it came to be, where they got the books from, the text from, how they came to put everything together. I told them to do some research on it. Some did. They found out they get to it, but they just don't want to use their common sense. We saw that. But now we've been in this system for quite a while. They know, but they just don't want to just apply what they know. That's from my experience at the SD Church Central Medina. They know, they just don't want to do it. About the African leaders thing. I believe it boils down to the people. It was not for this pre-colonial fragment that we have, these tribes, segregation, seclusion of peoples within the continent, I don't think we would have any problem with African unity, because it all boils down to the fragments we have on the continent. Just this country, we have, but I can just mention about 9 tribes. That's just in my dreams, ethnic groups.
Ethnic groups.
I mentioned about 9, 10, maybe 12. And I really don't find any consciousness towards we are all black people. Why don't we all come together? We have certain similarities in our languages. Yesterday I was talking to one girl from the northern region, a Dagbani girl. I was trying to learn certain things in their language, and I got to find out that there are similarities in their languages, comparing it to the three languages we have here. There were certain similarities. And I was talking to her about it, and she's like, yeah, there are similarities in our languages. And I was thinking, why are we to be coming together? I mean, we can just blur the ethnic lines and just let's make the unity a reality. I mean, we can start from this small geographical area and it can spread. But once again, it seems certain people want to hold on to this cherished quote unquote piece of land that they've gotten on their little part of the continent. They don't want to let go of this identity that they've made for themselves. So I would say it wasn't given to them by the white man, because before the white man came, there existed these fragments. I have a theory on how they came to be, and I got that theory from the destruction of black civilization. Just a theory, but until we blur the lines of the ethnic lines, it will be very difficult for an African unity. All starts from the ethnic groups. There are so many ethnic groups here, so many languages. The languages have similarities. As long as they refuse to realize these connections we have with each other, it's very difficult. I, for one, I see myself as African, and that's it. I have cultural specificity, but it's not really something that I want to attach myself to so much, because I know there's a bigger thing ahead of us. We have a future as an African people that we need to accomplish. We have been in the dead, we've been in the night. It's time for us to come out in the morn, and we'll go on to be our noon, which is our highest part, like we were in the Nile Valley civilization. So it's time for us to move on towards that phase. As I can go on and on about this one. Yeah, thanks.
All right, thank you very much. So, what do you think about? So, then after then double close us.
So for me, the discussion on religion, was something that brought back a thought. So recently I was in Lake for some trip to visit a good friend up there, apparently in Lake Bosom Trade, there is the church, the Catholic church there, they own a mountain. Apparently the leader or the chief gave a whole, I'm censoring my words here, mountain to the Catholic church. And they are not even doing, there is nothing in the town, but they've given a whole mountain to a church. This is like, I don't know, I really wanted to grab some pair of pliers and pull my tooth out because it was a pitiful sight, honestly. That's one. There's a lot of work to be done, to be honest. But talking about being African, for me, one of the remedies, I'm pretty sure there are so many, is that we travel. That is the only way that, for me, or one of the many ways that we can blur these lines, as you were saying. So pretty much, we've got to start moving around. We've got to stop seeing ourselves within this silly little fragment that have been carved out for us. I was telling a colleague here that, in December, I'm going to Senegal. You want to come? She's like, what? You want me to die? What do you mean? What do you mean? Seriously. Yeah, going to Mali. I'm like, I'm going to Mali. Do you want to come? People are like, they'll mention whatever the terrorist group was there, but I'm like, what? You know, you're watching CNN and you think that's your reality. What the heck? You'll go there and find out. I mean, you want to speak from an African consciousness. You want to be African. If you want to be, we should start experiencing all things which are African. And definitely traveling is one that we should all aspire to do. That's what I'll end with.
I know, Dr. Obadale, I don't want to in any way seem like I'm going against your very good suggestion of the Bibi Casa.
Bibi Tumi Casa.
But I found out by accident on what you call Jutu that Chancellor Williams' books, The Destruction of Black Civilization, is read in its entirety. So if you're into audiobooks, and I'm definitely into audiobooks, I came across that by accident. And I was able to listen to the book in its entirety in 2.5 days. So again, in terms of ideas, people get together, put your CDs together, buy credits. There are a lot of very good audiobooks read on YouTube. So if you think YouTube is just for videos, it's not the case. I've come across incredible information by Dr. Richard King, Dr. Francis Cresswell saying, I'm sure all of you have seen that as well, but I don't know how many of you know that there are books read in their entirety on YouTube. So that was the announcement that I wanted to make. And in particular, The Destruction of Black Civilization, it's in a 4 or 5 volume work, but it's read in its entirety.
And also one thing I recommend to my students along similar lines, if you have the PDF of any book, you can have it read to you. So if you have Acrobat, you go to the view menu, read out loud, then it'll read to you, and it can read to you at the speed that you desire. So that's how I'm able to read 600 page books in a day or two. All right, so, and then there's also an app for the phone called @voice, the @ and then voice. And the same PDF, if you open it up in the app, it will read it out to you. And, you know, because I understand that I'll have it on a fast speed, so then I'm cooking, I'm listening, I'm laying with my eyes closed, I'm listening. So those are other options as well. I wanted to, does everyone have a pen and based off some of the things that were being said. So it's reading to me. So you can have it just read whatever the book is. So let's come. We mentioned the colonization of time. He wants to really read to me now. Relax, relax. The colonization of time was mentioned. There's an excellent book called Time in the Black Experience. Time in the Black Experience. We use that in Foundations of African Thought. We use an article by Dr. Fukiao, the late Dr. Fukiao. The author is Joseph K., or the editor rather, Joseph K. Ajaye. A-D-J-A-Y-E, A-D-J-A-Y-E, Time in the Black Experience. And what it does, it goes all throughout the African world, both continent and diaspora, and it gives African concepts of time, right? So that's one. Also someone mentioned conscientism, right? That was, yeah. Now, one thing I want you to do as you're reading conscientism is look at the number of African philosophers and scholars who are cited versus the number of Eurasian, particularly Greek scholars that are cited. Now, in the opening of African studies, Kwame Nkrumah was trying to resolve this conflict that if all you know is Greek scholars, you can't choose any African scholars, right? So if I say, oh, pick up the 50 Ghana cedi bill that's here on the table and it's not there, how do you choose it, right? So what Nkrumah did in conscientism is he chose from all that he knew, but then as he was setting up African studies, he said, we have to, you know, do more, we have to learn our own stuff, because he didn't have that privilege growing up under colonial, quote-unquote, Gold Coast. So as you're reading it, again, look for the truth, not necessarily authority, and say, Kwame Nkrumah is the greatest, everything he did is what I'm going to do, let me go marry an Arab. We're going to look at it and say, how can we pick up, he took the machete to cut a path. How can I pick up that machete and cut it even further, right? What we pretend to do out of laziness is just stand here and clap for him and say, look at where he got to. Mm-hmm. Yeah, 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 right? But the best way to honor a fallen soldier is to pick up the gun, right, and continue the battle. So that's one thing, as you're looking at conscientism, just look at the number of those who are cited. But then when we come to the African side, it's, oh, African people are a collective. You know, where's the text that says that? Give me a proverb, give me an idiom, give me an ancient text in Medinetra, give me something, Merowitic something. Mm-hmm. But if you don't have access to it, how can you cite it? Mm-hmm. But now we have the access to it. So look at that when you're looking at conscientism. When we're talking about the start of the new year, for those of you from various ethnic groups in Ghana, you have Ujra. What time of the year is that, roughly?
Around September.
Around September. You look at Homowa. So all these are harvest, you know, times. If you look at ancient Kemet, you had the beginning of the Akhet, you know, season. So Akhet is the horizon. And you find that that's around the same time. So they would celebrate it. You know, you have the Shamu season, that's the end of the flood. And then you have the beginning of the Akhet season. So again, look at some of these things and research. You know, as we're saying this information, next time you get online, look up what is the, you know, beginning of the year and see how that correlates the ancient beginning of the year and the beginning of the year as we still do it now. Definitely it was not in December, but look at that correlation, because when you see this is the beginning of the year as we do it now, that was the beginning of the year as we did it then, you'll see it's the same thing. And you'll be able to actually do something. So that's the original 365-day calendar. Along those same lines, look up NABTA, N-A-B-T-A, Playa, NABTA Playa. So this is the oldest calendar, these megaliths that are set up in such a way that it aligns with specific constellations. And there's an entire field called archaeoastronomy. Archaeoastronomy. Actually gave a talk on that, talking about the connections between sciences and humanities. So we'll think about spiritual systems as humanities, but then we'll look at these are the hard sciences of math and whatever calculation. But in Kemet, that was not that division, that when we're doing a temple, we're aligning it perfectly with where this star is going to rise on this specific date, where the sun is going to shine in an Abu Simbel, it's going to shine into the inner sanctum on this specific day, and it's going to shine on the solar deities to let you know that we know what we're doing and it's on purpose. So, you know, look up, the talk I gave was 13,000 years and 13 minutes. 13,000 years and 13 minutes, and it goes through the alignment of all of these various temples, you know. Also, Israel was mentioned. Look up the Merenptah Stela, Merenptah Stela, M-E-R-E-N-P-T-A-H. When I went to Kemet, I got a chance to chill out with Merenptah, at least the statue. But they also call it the Israel Stela. It's the first instance of the mentioning of Israel in any text, right? And it gets towards the end. And the context where it's mentioned is that it talks about all of the enemies of Kemet who had been destroyed. And it says, Israel has been laid wasted. It is bare of seed. So actually read that. Merenptah, M-E-R-E-N-P-T-A-H, Stella, right? Now, when you're looking at, you know, oftentimes we're exposed to biblical things, which are the lies that the former Hyksos told us. Now, you may wonder what the Yah is when we're saying Yahweh and Yah, Yah, Yah. That this was a lunar deity, and look this up, put this in your notes. Yah, Yah. And the ruler who booted the Hyksos out of Kemet was named Yahmos. When I went to Kemet, I got a chance to see his mummy. It's in the museum at Waset. Very short, slight of build. But anytime you're hearing Moses, you know that there's a name of a deity that has been cut off. So you're saying Ramesses, you're saying Ra, born of, one who was born of the sun. Yahmoses, you're saying one who was born of the moon. So all of these various Moses is actually coming from this. So these were Hyksos, these were invaders to ancient Kemet. And they were booted out, rightfully so, in the first war of African liberation. So read up about the Hyksos, and then it will be very clear where they got the concept of Yah from. It will be very clear where they got the Ten Commandments from, out of the 42 of Ma'at. Also, so we're talking about also the various deities. So when you go to ancient Kemet, or when you start learning about the Metanetra, you also see that all of these deities, the Jesus that was being talked about, the Yeshua that was being talked about, if anyone named that ever existed, he could go to the temple at Ipetsut and read his entire biography and realize that his non-existent life was completely plagiarized, right? So this is information that you can actually read. There's a very brief documentary called Zeitgeist that goes into it in a very accessible way. But you'll find that all of these are solar stories, that when it's saying December 23rd, you're talking about the winter solstice. It stays there perceptibly for 3 days and then it rises 1 degree, the sun. So when you say dead for 3 days and it eventually rises, this is what you're talking about, exactly what she was saying about Easter. What you're actually doing is celebrating the spring equinox when the day becomes longer than the night. So all of these things that we do, we don't really understand it, but the reason I said put this in your notes is because I want you to check on it and actually read what is being talked about. This was carved in stone, yes?
What was it called again?
Which one?
The name of the...
Zeitgeist?
No, where you have the story about
her. Right, so this is, if you go to the Zeitgeist documentary that I mentioned, you can find it there, but then also go to the original text from ancient Kemet. So there's a three-volume series. It's a series of translations. Actually, let me first give you Théophile Obenga's text, which is African Philosophy, the Pharaonic Period. The best text, bar none, in terms of an anthology. African Philosophy, the Pharaonic Period. And it goes into this information there. All right. And then also, there is a series of literature. Ancient Egyptian Literature, Volume 1, Volume 2, and Volume 3. And you can find it in there as well. And what it is, Volume 1 is Old Kingdom and Middle Kingdoms. Volume 2 is Late Kingdom, and then, New Kingdom. Then volume three is the late period. So you can see that story in the different phases of ancient Kemet, 3,000 years before any of this. Also, you can look up the pyramid texts, right? Called of Unas, also called Wenis. And that is the oldest version of the story of the Holy Trinity, the death and resurrection of Savior, all of these concepts that we think judgment, all of those are found carved in the pyramid of Unas, also called Wenis. So that's the pyramid text. Finally, just in terms of how we saw our enemies, which are the Eurasians, look up the instructions to Mary Kare, M-E-R-I-K-A-R-A, and you can read this in its entirety in translation. If you are interested in learning Meghna Netra, you can come tomorrow at 1 and learn how to read it in the original source text. But it talks about basically what last week we looked at Sheikh Antajok, right? And in it, it says, lo, the miserable Asiatic. He is miserable because of the place he's in. Short of water, bare of wood, its paths are many and difficult. And basically it talks about when you look at Eurasian behavior, part of it is due to their lack of resources. And when you're in a lack of resource land, it makes you say, might makes right. Only the strong survive, survival of the fittest. That means if I'm a caveman and my club is bigger than yours, then boom, I can eat your child. You understand? So this is a concept that you find in Jok's two cradle theory, northern cradle and southern cradle, but predating Jok by thousands and thousands of years. This is an observation that our African ancestors saw as well. So on that, I hope we learned a lot. These are the quotes. I want you to go and verify it. If you know Greek, or if you know anyone who knows Greek, you can go and read it in the original Greek. Otherwise, you can cross-reference it with other translations and see if this is really what the Greeks said about where they got their information from. You can see if this is really what the Greeks said about this is what the Africans of Kemet look like. They were black, kinky hair, all of these different things. And always cross-reference and verify. Perhaps I'm just playing a big prank on you. Dr. Kambon, ha ha ha, he was just being silly. So don't believe, I don't want you to believe anything. I want you, instead of the time that you're spending supporting these Eurasians and socializing on non-African antisocial networks, I want you to go to sites and to apps and other things made by and for African people and be verifying the information, all right? So thank you for coming. Give yourselves a big round of applause. I'll give it back to you.
So thank you very much for staying to the end. Usually, we have this every Thursday, starting at 5 p.m. It's unlikely we are going to have it next week because the venue has been taken by School of Oriental and African Studies.
You may be able to do it down in the senior common room.
Okay, all right. So we'll send the emails around. If we have to change the venue and have it here downstairs, we'll send the emails around, okay? So thank you very much for coming. Next week, bring somebody.
John Henry Clark, African World Revolution is what's scheduled.
Okay, so next week we're having John Henry Clark, African
World Revolution.
So let's be here in our numbers. Let's bring friends who can be led out of the darkness, not those who are determined to stay in it. So yeah. Have a nice evening. Thanks for coming.
Very quickly. And the longer you stay in the light, the blacker you get. Remember that.